Good afternoon. This is Sunil Iyengar, Director of Research and Analysis at the National Endowment for the Arts in Washington, D.C. We'll get started now, but first a few rules of the road. First, you will all be muted and will be able only to hear us. The webinar will consist of two PowerPoint presentations and a short one minute video. Actually, it's two PowerPoint presentations and one short 1 minute video. Following our presentations will be a Q&A session. You can submit questions or comments at any time using the Q&A box below the PowerPoint you see on your screen. We will do our best to address as many as possible during the time we have. Please do not use the raise hand button. Also, please note that this webinar will be posted in the webinars section of our website in a few days, so you can refer to it in the future. And finally, there will be live tweeting going along, so you can follow that if you'd like at NEA Arts. So, welcome everyone to this installment of our quarterly public webinar series by the Federal Interagency Task Force on the Arts and Human Development. Just trying to get to the next. Just a moment. I'll be giving a brief update of some of our activities, and then we'll hear right away from Dr. Nadine Kaslow of Emory University. Last month, Dr. Kaslow began her service as president of the American Psychological Association. Although she was unable to join us live today, she has sent a special message by way of introducing our featured speaker for this webinar, James Kaufman, professor of educational psychology at the Neig School of Education at the University of Connecticut, and a leading authority on psychological research into the nature and assessment of creativity. Dr. Kaufman heads APA's Division 10, the Society for the Psychology of Aesthetics, Creativity, and the Arts. After Dr. Kaufman's presentation, I'll ask him a few questions, and then we'll turn it over to the audience for Q&A before ending this webinar promptly 1 hour after it began. Just a few updates on the 17-member Interagency Task Force on the Arts and Human Development, covering a variety of federal agencies and departments across government. Our mission remains to catalyze research and information sharing about the arts' role in contributing to positive health and educational outcomes across the lifespan. You can go to our dedicated webpage shown here to learn more about the task force, to see archived webinars and research publications, among other resources. Some publications include research from longitudinal databases about the arts' potential benefits for at-risk youth, a foundational white paper on the arts and human development, and Aging in the Arts, a report summarizing results from a National Academies workshop co-sponsored by three task force member entities from the National Institutes of Health, as well as the National Endowment for the Arts. A big project for the group right now is to produce a publication, most likely a literature review, based on a comprehensive search across databases at the National Library of Education and the NIH Library that would highlight the state of research into the arts and early childhood development. It most likely will focus on two broad areas: one, socio-emotional, and two, cognitive or physiological outcomes. At our last task force meeting a week ago, we learned that two research funding concepts, either directly inviting arts-related research applications or highlighting the eligibility of such applications, are working their way through the National Institutes of Health, and we look forward to updating you as we learn more. And finally, at our last meeting, responding to interest from members, we held a series of brief presentations about Native American or tribal community needs that dovetail with some of the priorities and missions of the task force member agencies. Speakers included representatives from the Administration for Community Living at the Department of Health and Human Services, a colleague from the National Endowment for the Arts, as well as from the National Endowment for the Humanities. We're grateful to have had their experiences and perspectives inform our efforts. I want to draw your attention to the next two dates shown here for the remaining task force webinars this fiscal year. Please put them in your calendars and stay tuned for details and speakers and topics. You can also email us anytime at fedtaskforce@arts.gov. We're also pleased to announce the arrival of a new member on the task force, Dr. Erwin Tan, a geriatrician, from the Corporation of National and Community Service. So thank you, Dr. Tan, for joining us. Now for today's topic. For the first 2 years of these webinars, we focused on arts and human development related research or programming underway at member agencies or departments participating in the task force. Last year, we wanted to take a different approach. There was a great deal of interest in understanding evidence-based constructs, concepts, and definitions for creativity. Last November, for example, we featured the work of Dr. Rex Jung, a neuroscientist at the University of New Mexico. And today, we're looking at the psychology of creativity. Dr. Kaufman's presentation centers on a 4C model of creativity, which he co-developed with Ronald Baghetto at the University of Oregon. In a 2009 paper, Drs. Kaufman and Baghetto wrote, quote, "We see the 4C model as representing a developmental trajectory of creativity in a person's life," end quote, which is what resonates very nicely with the interests of the Interagency Task Force on the Arts and Human Development. So in a moment, James, but first, Dr. Nadine Caslow, new director for the American Psychological Association. And I'd like to tell people who may be only listening in and not online that you won't hear the audio portion of this on the phone, so it'd be nice if you could be at a computer and just turn up your speakers. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Dr.
Hello, my name is Dr. Nadine Caslow, and I'm the 2014 president of the American Psychological Association. I am honored to be able to spend a few minutes with you today during this segment of your webinar series. Of course, anyone would be extremely pleased to have the opportunity to visit with such a talented group of art and human development leaders. But I am especially pleased to have the opportunity to do so because of my lifelong personal and professional dedication to the arts, to human welfare, and to the combination of the two. I am also flattered to be part of the same webinar as Dr. James Kaufman. When you visit Dr. Kaufman's website, you will see what I suspect is a guiding principle of his work. Quote, "Researching the human behavior of creativity to help the world be a better place," close quote. Well said, James. The arts have always been a part of my life. I started dancing ballet when I was 3, and I grew up dancing with the Pennsylvania Ballet Company and in their school. However, I was also drawn to psychology and the opportunities that it afforded me to help people. But I've never lost my roots in dance and the arts. To this day, I continue to dance ballet, and I serve as the psychologist for the Atlanta Ballet. It means so much to me that I have found many meaningful ways to integrate the arts and psychology in my life. During my APA presidential year and the upcoming APA annual meeting in Washington, D.C., I will be sponsoring a number of events and programs to highlight the importance of the arts and their role in creating community, life satisfaction, efficacy, self-image, and cognitive development, as well as enhancing and fostering creativity. I look forward to working with James and other members of APA's Division 10, the Society for the Psychology of Aesthetics, Creativity, and the Arts on many.
Okay, without any ado then, James.
Okay, I'm gonna first start by just saying that it's a real privilege and honor to be able to chat about my favorite topic in the world, or at least one of my favorite topics in the world, with a bunch of people who are also excited and interested. So the way I always start off talking about creativity is to simply ask, what is creativity? How do we define it? And in fact, one of the cliches of a lot of articles is to start off by saying that people are still debating or arguing about what creativity is. But in fact, there's a pretty solid consensus among creativity researchers. Let's say that you want me to tell you a creative story. I say, okay. And I say, once upon a time, there was a boy. The end. Is that creative? Most people would say no. Creativity typically needs to be something that's new, that's different, that is unique, innovative. There's some component of it that is new. Well, how about this? Once upon a time, there was an elephant. and the elephant took the rhubarb, and it made John Adams tap dance until the number 17 was permanently ingrained in the mindsets of everybody who had ever seen the TV show The Mentalist. Is that creative? Most creativity researchers would say no. Now, on one hand, that was a very unique story. It was probably a brief sentence that has never been said before. However, creativity has two main components. One is novelty, the newness that I mentioned before. The other component is that creativity needs to be task appropriate, useful. This does not mean socially appropriate. It can be wild and outrageous, but it should address the basic components of the task at hand. Another way to think of creativity is to think about the four P's. And as those who have dove into the creativity literature know, we like our letter acronyms. So one P is the creative person, and that's whoever is being creative. And people who focus on the creative person, for example, might look at what types of people are creative. What do we know about creative people? There's also the creative process, and this is what happens when we're creative. How does it happen? What are the ways that we think when we're being creative? What happens as we're being creative? There's also the creative product, and that can be anything from a painting to a novel to a scientific equation or a formula to an amazing dish that you might eat. And finally, there's the creative press, which really is the creative environment, but then it would be three P's and an E, which is a lot harder to remember than the four P's. And this is the world around you that can help nurture or suppress your creativity. Another way of looking at it is a model that I've developed with my good friend and colleague, Ron Baghetto, who is actually now at the University of Connecticut, not Oregon, which is the 4C model. And this we see as a developmental trajectory that looks at the development of creativity. We start with mini C, and this is personal creativity, the individual insights that people get when they try something, possibly for the first time. This then can evolve into little C, and little C is creativity that can be acknowledged and recognized by other people. So at the mini C level, it might be something that is creative only to you. At the little C level, other people are responding in some way. The next level is pro C, professional C, and these are the creative experts. These are the people who are creative at a very high level. And these are the people who are the business people and professors and professional artists and professional cooks, the people who have usually put in about 10 years of deliberate practice towards becoming an expert. And finally, there's big C, and this is legendary or eminent creativity. And this is the kind of powerful, long-lasting, domain-changing creativity that can be remembered hundreds of years from now. And this is Mozart and Einstein and people like that. Another important point as we think about how we define or conceptualize creativity is that you can be creative in many different domains, and that obviously art is a top domain to be creative in, but you can be creative in business or science or everyday life or interpersonal communication, a wide variety of domains. In addition to how we define creativity, is the larger question of how do we measure creativity? And it sounds almost sacrilegious to try to measure something that is so amorphous, that is so special, and yet we do. Probably the most common way of measuring creativity is with divergent thinking tests. And these were pioneered by people like J.P. Guilford and Paul Torrance dating back to the 1950s. the construct of divergent thinking focuses on the idea of when you're given an open-ended question and you have to come up with many, many different ideas, how can you do that? So for example, maybe I ask you, how many uses can you think of for a brick? Well, fluency is how we score it for the number of ideas that you have. And this would be, okay, well, you say, what can I do with a brick? I could use it as a weapon. I could use it as a paperweight. I could use it as a piece of modern art. And we would count every single idea that you say that is an appropriate answer. Flexibility is how many categories you use when you answer the question. So maybe I say that I could use a brick as a paperweight to hold papers on my desk. And then I say I could use a brick to hold booklets on my desk. And then I say I would use a brick as a paperweight to hold brochures on my desk. This is all the same category, paperweight. A third way is originality, and this is how rare your ideas are. So there are some things that people might say that is very common. So saying that you'd use a brick to build something with, that's something a lot of people say. There are other things, like perhaps something you're thinking of right now, that nobody else would say. Another common measure is based on the association theory. And this looks at the way that we make associations in our brain. So for example, if I say cow, right away you're going to have different associations that pop into your mind. Maybe you think of grass, cud. Maybe you think of milk, which then leads to cheese, which then might lead to cheddar. Maybe you think of burgers. Maybe you think of other animals like goats. You might think of all sorts of things. Some of them are going to be very immediate connections. So for example, a cow and milk is a very close connection. Many people will think of it. Other connections might be much more remote, such as, for example, the cow and Bart Simpson. There is a natural connection, but it's a little more convoluted. The remote associates test uses this idea, and it gives you three words that are all connected by a fourth word. So in this example, there's sleeping, bean, and trash. How are they all connected? Bag. Sleeping bag, bean bag, trash bag. Another way that people measure creativity, which is probably my favorite, is that people actually produce something creative. So you would have many people writing poems or drawing pictures or creating mathematical equations or business plans. And these would then be rated for creativity by people who are qualified experts. And these experts might be poets or scientists or business people, depending on the domain. It might be teachers. It might be advanced students of that area. It might even be the creator, him or herself, giving a self-assessment. This technique for measuring creativity, and indeed an awful lot about creativity, uses up a lot of resources. And this is something that I'm going to turn for a little bit of this chat to, which is that creativity takes time, it takes money, it takes effort. It's not easy. And I think it's important to realize that, because creativity, people often ask the question, well, is creativity a good thing or a bad thing? I mean, most people would agree creativity is good. The key is it worth the resources? Now, I believe the answer is yes, which is unsurprising given this is what I do. At the pro-C level, creativity is important because of the effect it can have in the economy, among many other reasons. So businesses that value creativity tend to do better. They tend to are more likely to have big financial breakthroughs, and this is all based on scientific studies. And indeed, people tend to prefer products that are more creative. People who are creative tend to be promoted more, they make more money, they're more likely to start a new job and have it be start a new career and have it be successful, they're more likely to be satisfied. But even beyond that, there's a lot of wonderful personal benefits. People who are creative are more likely to be in better physical health. They're more likely to be happier and be in good moods. They're more likely to be able to cope with stress or trauma and be resilient. So what can we do to be more creative? If it's associated with all these good things, how can we help people be more creative? One of the first things is that inspiration is overrated. Having that amazing idea hit you like a thunderbolt is a great idea. It's a great, wonderful thing. But if you wait for it, you're not going to be creative. Creativity is incredibly linked with knowledge, expertise, and persistence. If you want to be a creative writer, that means you have to read, it means you have to write, and it means you have to rewrite. It means you have to study and practice and keep doing it over and over again. And this is something that isn't quite as sexy as having that amazing inspiration, but it's much more important. Creativity, like intelligence, is malleable. It's not fixed. So in other words, if you keep trying, you can be creative. You can be more creative if you keep working at it. You may not, for example, reach the levels of a Mozart or a Beethoven if you want to compose music, but you will be able to get better and compose more creative music. If you look at the question of what are creative people like, there's a ton of work on creativity and personality, and the most consistent finding involves openness to experience. Being open to experience is dependent on your intellectual and experiential curiosity. So what does that mean? It means that you're willing to try new things, and you are right now looking at a picture of me trying durian in Singapore for the first time. This was not an incredibly pleasant experience, but it is that willingness to try something new. It's also liking intellectual challenges. It's liking thinking deep thoughts and having these intense conversations. And it's using your imagination. It's allowing yourself these flights of fancy or to daydream or to think a little bit and just enjoy those thoughts. Openness to experience is highly linked to creativity, no matter what the domain, no matter how you measure it, no matter how creative you are, whatever level, it's linked with openness to experience. In addition, knowing about creativity helps. Knowing, for example, that there are these many dimensions of creativity, like the four C's, you don't necessarily have to be Mozart to be creative. Knowing that creativity can happen across so many different genres and domains helps. Knowing all the different things that people think about creativity that might not be true helps. And indeed, along those lines, I want to give a brief shout out to American Psychological Association's Division 10, which is the Society for Psychology of Aesthetics, Creativity, and the Arts. You can join the division without being an APA member, and you get this lovely journal, Psychology of Aesthetics, Creativity, and the Arts. I am the current president, and in August, Stephen Pritzker will be the new president, and I think there's a lot of really exciting stuff going on. Another thing to think about is the role of motivation. People are more creative when they are personally interested. There's this thing called intrinsic motivation, or being motivated by internal reasons, out of enjoyment, out of love, out of passion. This is more associated with creativity. Rewards can reduce intrinsic motivation. So if we give extra credit or money or excessive praise to children or employees or just people in general, that can actually reduce how motivated they feel. Not always. It depends. The research is complicated. But if you can hold on to that passion, you will be more creative. Finally, there's the idea that I've also been exploring with Ron Baghetto of creative metacognition. People should know when to be creative and have a general idea of how creative they are. Sometimes that means learning how to be creative and getting these tools to be more creative. And sometimes it means to know when is the appropriate time to be creative. Sometimes it's not a great time to be creative. For example, if you're an airplane pilot and you are going in for a routine landing, it's not a great time to be creative. It's a really good time to land the plane the exact same way that you've done before. Or if you're a surgeon and you're doing a routine procedure, the best thing is, if everything is going right, to do it the exact same way. However, if an engine falls or if the patient starts hemorrhaging blood, that's a great time to be creative. And indeed, we're used to thinking about nurturing creativity being like Bruce Wayne becoming Batman. You must give people the tools to be creative. And that is a great thing. That is important. But it's also important to think about Superman, who was already creative, or if you want to use superpowers as a creativity metaphor, but he had to learn to become Clark Kent to be effective. And he had to learn, in essence, when to tone it down, when to modulate himself. And on that note, I'm going to sign off and take questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, James. And I just want to remind people who've tuned in to please submit questions or comments at any time using the Q&A box below the PowerPoint you see on your screen. And we'll do our best to address as many of those. While those questions are getting queued up, let me just remind people that these slides will be, and the webinar itself will be archived again, as I mentioned, on the NEA website. So let me just start off with a couple questions, James. You, in one of your papers, I think it was the one I referenced, the one that really laid out this four C's concept, you pointed out, in the beginning of the paper, you pointed out that in 1950, the president of the American Psychological Association issued a challenge to members by saying, I've looked into it, and the field of creativity research is minimal, and so far, 0.2% of all psychological research involves studies of creativity. We can do better. And this is actually a few years before the Sputnik incident, yeah, as you point out. And so I guess, where are we now in terms of, my impression, and correct me if I'm wrong, is that there are several budding research centers on creativity that are springing up nationally and internationally. And so two-pronged question, are you seeing a kind of growth in that area, that research focus, and how's that manifest? Is that through cross-disciplinary kinds of collaborations? Is it tend to be concentrated in psychology or management or entrepreneurship? You could speak a little bit about that.
Absolutely. I think we are at an amazing renaissance time for creativity research. I think that part of that is seeing the number of journals that are publishing creative work, from Psychology of Aesthetics, Creativity, and the Arts to the Pioneering Creativity Research Journal and Journal of Creative Behavior. And there's more work being done on creativity than has ever been done. And this research and the interest in it, what's wonderful is that it comes from so many places. I mean, psychology is a dominant player, but so is education, so is business, so is engineering. And one of the most important things that can happen in creativity research as a field is to have people from all these different disciplines communicate better, in that right now there's still so much jargon in each field, and the more that people from these disparate fields can communicate, and possibly through publishing in creativity journals as opposed to their domain specific journals, I think the better. I think that more and more colleges and universities are offering programs that focus on creativity. So two long-term programs, one is in Buffalo, one is Saybrook in Northern California, and at the University of Connecticut, along with my colleagues, Jonathan Plucker, Ron Baghetto, Joe Renzulli, and a lot of other amazing people, we are starting a lot of research centers and eventual programs on creativity. So I really see an amazing resurgence also in public interest. People are interested in creativity and in what the science actually says in a way that just wasn't true in several decades ago.
Thank you, James. And actually, to follow that up, speaking about going across domains, is the research pretty strong on, just to take the arts, for example, we often talk about ways in which there are potential benefits of the arts for particular other domains, whether other academic disciplines, whether people have arts education and on the one hand, and if they learn through arts education, they perhaps gain competencies in other areas involving maybe even math, science, and other types of domains. There's some literature on that. Is there literature on creativity across domains, to take the arts as an example, or any other a field of endeavor with creativity, that being creative in one particular knowledge domain somehow benefits creativity in other knowledge domains, or is it very knowledge domain specific?
It's actually a fascinating question, and one that there is quite extensive both research and debate on. I think that looking at a number of the studies, being creative in one domain has its own unique pattern of knowledge, but also to a degree personality and thinking styles and patterns of intelligence versus other domains. So for example, being conscientious, somebody who really kind of dots your I's, crosses your T's, is very important for being creative in science and business, but it actually hurts creativity in the arts sometimes. And similarly, creativity in most domains requires so much domain knowledge that is not necessarily going to be transferable. However, I think that people who are very creative in one domain will be at an advantage for other domains. So some of this is that there are some domain general creativity traits, like being open to experience. And I think part of it is that if you're used to having these behaviors and mindsets that have helped you be creative in, let's say, writing, then if you tackle another domain with that same persistence, then I believe that you will be at an advantage.
Great, and questions have started to roll in. James, one question is, I've read that children become less creative as they age, with the youngest children being considered, quote, creative geniuses, at least on Torrance tests. As you know, Torrance tests are to measure, assess creativity, but losing this capacity as they age. Is there compelling evidence to support this trend? If so, what suggestions do you have for offsetting declines in creativity as children grow?
It's very interesting because this is something that many, many people believe to be true. The science is less convinced from my read of it, in that they're usually, it's often called the fourth grade slump, but most researchers today don't really find a lot of evidence for that. Part of that is that if you look at being creative in terms of as actually creating products, so writing poems or putting on plays or drawing pictures, it is so related to practice and domain knowledge and experience that older kids do more creative work. It is certainly possible that the process of schooling, the process of advancing in school, certainly it will consistently reward good behavior as opposed to creative behavior. There have been a number of studies that show that a lot of teachers may unconsciously not love creative behavior, and indeed it can be disruptive. So I think that there is certainly a danger of creativity being drummed out of kids, either by this emphasis on standardized tests and the curriculum, or by this kind of unconscious or conscious social pressure. But if you look at general results, there isn't a level of decline that I find worrisome.
Now, you've talked about, I think it's, correct me if the term is wrong, metacognitive creativity, or is it creative metacognition? It's one of the two.
Creative metacognition, yeah.
Yes, creative metacognition. I don't think this was necessarily featured in this particular presentation, but I know there are a lot of educational people, researchers, and practitioners on this call, on this webinar, listening in. And could you speak a little bit about what the implications are for educational policy, specifically around this concept of maybe you can explain that concept first a little bit, metacognitive creativity, but also how that ties in with wanting to nurture what you've called the small C, mini C rather, and that capability in children. Because I've seen a question or two about, one of the questions is, I'd like to hypothesize that individuals suppress their creative tendencies out of fear that they will be perceived as atypical, abnormal, or even deviant. So I think this resonates with what you're saying about whether teachers or whoever it is have biases against certain kinds of creative, creativity as it's manifest, say, in a classroom. So my general question is, do you have any kind of thoughts about what the practical lessons are for educational policy or practice with regard to nurturing mini-C in a way that contributes to broader outcomes?
Absolutely. So trying to unpack that, the question, there's so much very rich fodder for discussion in that. One aspect of creative metacognition, which is the being able to read the context, one reason why Ron and I emphasize that so much is that most teachers have nothing against creative students. As in, I don't want to give the impression that, oh, all teachers just, go out and they hate creative kids and they think, boy, I hate these kids, because that's not true. But a lot of teachers, with very good reason, don't want a class to get sidelined. They don't particularly want it to descend into chaos. And one way that a creative child might manifest her or his creativity might be through being bored and saying things that might be off target or doing things that are raising issues that other kids may not be interested in at that moment. And it's a fine line of balancing how to encourage those kids and yet not let the class be hijacked. So one aspect of the creative metacognition is this learning how to be creative in different situations. So there are some situations when it's great to say whatever's on your mind and to be creative and allow yourself that. There are other times when it might be better to jot a note to yourself, to explore it later, or to ask the teacher a question after class or set up a time to talk to the teacher. And that part of that is the importance of context. In addition, another thing that we're very interested in is this idea of learning about your own creativity and having insight into what areas am I creative in. In that, if you're wanting to be creative, knowing what domains might be the best possibilities for you is very important, and that ideally a good teacher or mentor or parent can be a guide and seeing what the child is interested in, seeing their passions, and helping them find the best creative outlet.
Great. And I think the educational line of inquiry kind of struck a nerve. A lot of people are asking kind of the same question. Are there any kind of classroom resources or kits that you recommend for fostering creativity in middle or high school classrooms? I don't know if it's as simple as that, given what you're saying, but if you have any resources you want to point our attention to.
Not to plug myself, but I think I can, because I'm only third author on this, but Ron Baghetto and John Baer and I have a book coming out in a few months on creativity and the curriculum. But there are many outstanding books on this. One of the things that I believe is particularly important is for teachers to find ways of teaching the curriculum in ways that are creativity friendly. So for example, you know, creativity doesn't necessarily mean that you only focus on how to be creative. Creativity can be nurtured and taught within a vocabulary lesson, within teaching mathematics, that you can keep it tied to the curriculum and, in essence, do both.
Great. Somebody is asking, do some cultures encourage creativity more than other cultures, i.e. cultures that are oriented toward conformity?
Certainly, cultures value different aspects of creativity. So for example, there's been a lot of research that's cross-cultural, particularly looking at East versus West. And one of the findings that a lot of people have found is that the West tends to value originality. We tend to value pure innovation, pure being totally original. The East will often value being creative as adaptation, as taking place within the environment. So perhaps taking something that's established and tinkering with it, making it better in a creative way. So that's an example where the culture definitely impacts the way that people are creative. I don't know if I would necessarily say that cultures are more or less creative. I think it's just how it's expressed.
Great. So this question is posed in as sort of a challenge. The questioner is referring to the positive psychologist Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi. He says, who's known as, he's quoting him, Mr. Flow. He says that in a 1996 book, he reminds us that Van Gogh was creative once, quote, a sufficient number of art experts felt that his paintings had something important to contribute to the domain of art. In other words, there had to be a consensus before the artist was deemed creative. Then he's quoting again from Dr. Csikszentmihalyi. Without such a response, Van Gogh would have remained where he was, a disturbed man who painted strange canvases. So the questioner is asking, your presentation seems to imply that researchers know what creativity is, how it can be measured, and even how it can be fostered. Do you think you would have recognized Van Gogh in his lifetime? You don't need to answer that last piece, but I guess the question
that's a great question, though, because it also allows me to voice some of my own displeasure with creativity measurement, which is that I think that if we give the standard creative measurements, I don't think we could have found Van Gogh at all. However, if we use this consensual assessment technique, which is the one where you have people do creative things, then a good creativity researcher would have had his paintings looked at by appropriate experts or other artists. So I think that a good creativity researcher would have known enough to have brought in the artists to have helped with the recognition of Van Gogh's creativity.
Sounds suspiciously like an NEA grant review panel. actually, just wanted to know with that. Actually, speaking of assessment, what was the name of that tool?
The consensual assessment technique, and it was pioneered by Teresa Amable in the 1980s. But people have done hundreds and hundreds of studies using it. I mean, the biggest disadvantage is that it's a pain in the ass. It's hard to get a large amount of experts to do anything, let alone to rate bunches of artwork or poems or things like that.
Right. And actually, that kind of touches, I mean, that reaches into this other topic, which is, you know, within arts education, struggle to, you know, assess arts education, whether it's capacity or skills or competencies by the student, but also potential outcomes that they're demonstrating through that work. Reaching toward positive outcomes in various domains. I guess what I'm asking is, why do you think that schools and universities, and this may be a naive question, have not really assimilated or used these kinds of techniques? Is it because of the cost? Is it primarily because standardized tests that don't incorporate such measures are just easier and much more easily validated across large samples of the population? Or why hasn't the Torrance test or any of these particular tests really caught on in a big way in curricular development?
It's a great question, and it's something, I mean, I worked at Educational Testing Service for 2 years and learned an awful lot there. And one thing I learned is that anything that can be faked or taught can't be used. And the fact is that if you said to me, I'm going to give you $1 million if you can improve my creativity score, I could improve your creativity score. And as a result, like the Torrance tests and their ilk are very good for many things, but for high-stakes testing, like really high-stakes, people can manipulate the system. And with the consensual assessment technique, to a degree, this is very similar to the technique that ETS uses in rating its essays. They bring a bunch of people, and they read the essays, and they show a certain amount of rater agreement. Why don't we use
talking about the you're talking about the Educational Testing Service, right?
Yes, or any way that the like GRE writing is scored.
Right.
Although I think they also use computers now. I mean, a lot of it does come down to money and resources. I mean, there. So, for example, there are some colleges that have started using creativity in the admissions process. And Robert Sternberg, who's a legend in creativity research, is one of the pioneers in this area. And if you look at the colleges that have started to do this, one of the neat side effects is that minority enrollment goes up. If you look at the SATs, the GREs, IQ tests, achievement tests, there are these differences by SES, sometimes by gender and ethnicity. And there are many reasons for these differences. A lot of them involve things like bias and stereotype threat and other things that do not necessarily reflect people's ability. If you look at creativity tests, there are no such differences. And the implications are kind of amazing, and particularly when creativity is a major human cognitive ability. It's something that is overlooked because of the expense, because of the fact that we don't have an amazing measure of it right now that is both easy to give and cheap. And there's a long way to go.
And actually, the questioner, the Van Gogh questioner, actually points out that that don't worry, other artists and experts didn't recognize Van Gogh either. So I think you're off the hook there. Now, actually,
I'll take what I can get.
so another question is you know, I'm thinking about the so the last presenter we had for this webinar series, Rex Jung, spent some time talking about a period of dormancy. Or latency when in the brain when creativity seems to be working, which are periods when you know the subject seems to have a lot of time and is somewhat relaxed, maybe not so agitated, and is actually you know essentially ruminating and you know prior to a creative act or an insight. One thing I didn't hear a lot about, and maybe you have some thoughts about this, is the role of leisure time and the degree to which you feel stress and daily stresses are either inimical or contribute to high creativity. And that's, again, a fused kind of question because I'm asking about leisure time on the one hand and also about stress. But your thoughts about sort of in day-to-day, you know, the busyness of general life, like how do people, where's creativity in the mix and how does one safeguard it?
I think that they can both in their own way help creativity depending on the level and the scenario. So at the pro-C level, if stress is coming, let's say, from competition, then that can help. So if you look at, you know, expert level business people or scientists, competition can bring out the best. And it can key you up, it can serve as almost as adrenaline. If you're talking about little C or everyday creativity, stress is less good. And this is where leisure time can serve, in essence, one of two functions. One function is that it's an amazing outlet for creativity itself. So there are many, many, many people who maybe in their 9-to-5 job don't have a tremendous opportunity to express creativity, but can use their leisure time to express their creativity in an astounding number of domains. I mean, from knitting to cooking to anything. And it could also serve as a chance to let yourself ruminate, and that doing something for pleasure, for leisure, is a way of letting your brain kind of unwind. And obviously Rex knows much more about this than I do, but that aha moment, that moment where you're like, wait, I get it. One way to distract yourself is engaging in leisure activities, you know, playing a video game that's not engaging all of your brain, or reading a book about something totally different that triggers an idea. So in this sense, leisure time can either be the outlet itself, or it can be something that can invigorate you.
James, do you consider yourself creative? Do people suddenly expect you to be creative at cocktail parties and that sort of thing? And what drew you to this area of research?
Am I creative? I would like to think I am. I hesitate to say what C I would put myself on, maybe, you know, somewhere between little and pro, depending on the domain. I was a creative writing major in college. I worked with T. Cragason Boyle, who is a very well-known novelist, and I wanted to be a creative writer all my life. And I assumed I was going to do that, and then one day I sent out all my applications for MFAs in creative writing, and one of the programs said, in essence, if you can do anything but creative writing, do that. Because every year we graduate like 15 MFAs, and every year there are 25 jobs in the entire country for people with MFAs. And I thought about it, and I said, you know what? I can do something else. Both of my parents are PhD psychologists. They do IQ stuff. And I began applying to psychology PhDs kind of as a lark. I was very lucky that I was a double major in psychology and worked with John Horn, who is a legend and amazing human being. And when I started grad school, I still didn't know I wanted to do creativity. But after 2 years of floundering and realizing that I really didn't like memory research, I went and I thought back to what are the things I really care about, and I came back to creative writing. And I thought, I think I'll try this. And I fell in love.
Great. I think you made a lot of people happy with that decision. Now, I was wondering, we alluded to this a little bit, you know, and certainly this is a big feature in your own research, is this concept of the mini-C. Can you just talk a little bit about, and you know, I think some of the people in the arts, for example, in arts-related research, you don't often hear about the concept of play, except in certain, you know, areas of arts research, certainly developmental psychology. But I'd love it if you could just explain a bit to people what the concept of play is, and maybe how that relates directly to what you're talking about in terms of creativity. Is it the same thing or not necessarily?
It is certainly very strongly related. One particular type of play is called imaginative play, and Sandy Russ has done a lot of the research on this, and she's done some great work, where when kids play, you know, sometimes they make up their own games, sometimes they will, in essence, play act and play roles. These are all examples of imaginative play. And this is a chance for them to, in this kind of safe way, explore their creativity. And what's neat is that it's very, very strongly related to creativity at a later time. And it makes sense. People, you know, in some ways you can almost envision this line where it starts at imagination, it develops into creativity, and if it keeps going, it kind of becomes possibly innovation or entrepreneurship or genius or these other manifestations of creativity. And a lot of mini-C can be play. So a lot of mini-C, you know, it's these personal insights. It's these moments of intimate discovery. And it might be doing something that hundreds of thousands of other people have already done, but it's new to you. So maybe you're starting to finger paint for the first time. I mean, probably I'm talking more about children, although adults can experience mini-C obviously as well. You might be painting something that nobody else would think is creative, but is meaningful to you. And it's this personal exploration, it's this self-insight that is, you can find it in play, you can find it when you first try to do something creative, and you can find it with a sudden insight about something that's totally unrelated to what you do. And it's pretty fun.
Great. I want to also point out to people that James contributed a very lively blog post to the Artworks official blog of the NEA website, Artworks, a few days ago. And I remember in it, one of the things you said was, James, you know, that to ask the hard questions about, I'm paraphrasing you, asking the hard questions about creativity, you also have to think about sort of the value proposition relative to other kinds of skills and assets. So it's not that you necessarily promote creativity in all contexts, as you've pointed out. You know, there's a time for creativity in certain settings, thinking of the airline pilot. But you also seem to be saying in that article toward the end that that even for businesses and even for groups that are consciously trying to be more creative, they have to maybe look at what the resource costs are to cultivate that creativity versus doing something else operationally for their organization. Can you just, it's just an open-ended kind of question, but can you speak a little bit about how your own research may be getting into that area of looking at cost benefits associated with creativity?
Absolutely. One of the things I want to see creativity researchers do more and more of is, you know, we're very good at doing work on how we can improve creativity, and we're very good at doing work that shows how creativity is linked with good things. What I'd like to see us do more of is showing how creativity is better than other things, or worse, if the case may be, at giving us these good outcomes. So, for example, if you're looking as an outcome variable of happiness, are people happier who are, so we know that people who are creative are happy, but is it better to be creative, or is it better to be smart, or is it better to be popular, or is it better to be attractive? These are all questions that we can answer, and that can help inform these decisions about how to allocate resources. And obviously nothing is this concrete. Creativity is a magnificent goal for its own right. But I feel like if we had some really solid research that shows, look, you know, not only is creativity important, but compared to these other 10 things that we value and give money towards, creativity is more important in producing, you know, kids who are happy, or kids who are successful, or adults who are successful, or companies that flourish. And so, for example, as part of that, it's a whole series of studies that I've been doing of, in essence, using creativity to try to predict things. So one study that I began at Cal State San Bernardino that we're still collecting data on is using creativity in other constructs like motivation, personality, thinking styles to predict eventual graduation rates and retention and GPA in college students. And I don't know what we're going to find. We might find things that won't thrill me, but I'd rather know.
Great. Thank you very much. That's about all the time we have. I did want to ask you one more thing. When will your new book that you referred to, Creativity and Curriculum, be coming out?
If my co-authors and I can get it to the publisher by the day we've said that we could, it should be out towards the later part of this year. If not, everybody should email me and yell at me.
All right, great. Thanks a lot, James. We very much appreciated this time with you, and thanks to all of you who tuned in. Again, this webinar will be archived, as with all the other interagency task force webinars. We had a lot of questions. If you have more, feel free to send them in. Otherwise, we look forward to our next webinar in May. Thank you very much.
Thank you.